It's big, but it just got bigger. The Kingsborough Family Church, with support from churches in Oxbridge, Hillenden and Hayes, presents Holy Night of Praise 2016. 29th of October 2016 at the Bex Theatre, Grange Road in Hayes, UB3 2UE. Doors open at 5 p.m. Ministering are the face of integrity music in Britain, Neil Robinson, international gospel rapper A Star, Mobile Award winner Rachel Kerr, international worship pastor Danny Oates, songwriter and gospel music producer Evans Aboy, God's own vessel of praise Dyer Balo, comedian of the United Nations MC Mark, the living act of the Kingsborough Family Church and the host choir HOP. For more information, visit our website at www.hallynight.org, and remember, why Halloween when you can hallelujah.
Father, we just thank you in Jesus' name for this grand opportunity to be in such a wonderful church with such wonderful pastors, God. Father, I pray that after I leave today that they see significant shifting, significant change. I thank you, Lord God, that you would open the windows of heaven and begin to pour out blessings over this house. Let's pray. Come on, lift your voices. No, pray in the spirit. Broko shidai. Alakata yakone mejotori ajada. Abango tu ragasteke tede booja. Leke si kitara na ma. Anjuko tovaja brezo toji ata nebrosha ezutu jigetara kesto kotare manja. Father, we just thank you. We thank you for this service this morning, Lord. We thank you for the lives of the people that you'll speak to this morning, God. And I thank you, Lord God, that you'll bring to remembrance those things that I've studied, Lord God. And I thank you, Lord God, that the word that I preach today will further this house and encourage this house, God, and give them a spirit of influence like they've not known, in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated this morning. I want to thank God for a wonderful connection through Prophetess Francina Norman, who's been a friend to me for several years. I mean, several years. And God gave her a vision to do a prophetic conference here in the UK. And I can't tell you if anybody from America who's ever did such. And I thought it was very bold and courageous. And as I sat there with her, I agreed to come. And as I sat there with her, I told her, definitely, it was God that you heard. I mean, so many lives were touched and changed. So I want to make sure that I say today, I thank you, if she watches this or see it. But I wouldn't be here today if it had not been for the door that she opened. I'm very appreciative. And then I'm very appreciative of my pastors. I don't know if you've heard of them, but Apostle Ivy and Dr. Bridget Hilliard of the New Light Church in Houston, Texas. I am covered. I'm not out on my own doing my own thing. Amen. I'm a woman under authority. Praise the Lord. I'm submitted to them. And I stood up yesterday and I forgot to say that. And I want to make sure that I don't forget to say that this morning. Amen. But are you ready for the word?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Pastors, let me tell you what the Lord spoke to me as I was sitting there. You're a very bright man when it comes to putting things together and organizing things and bringing certain campaigns and casting vision. You're full of vision. You're full of futuristic things. And because you're so full of futuristic things in the way that you're wired and you work, it's as if the people are not keeping up with you. And sometimes it kind of frustrates you. And you go, but I'm bringing this, and I'm doing this, and I'm bringing this, and I'm giving this. And it just don't seem like, when you're talking to the Lord, it just don't seem like I'm doing enough. But you're doing enough. It's just that you're so far ahead in vision. You're so far out there in vision. But I hear the Lord saying, it's not time for you to turn around. So don't be discouraged. God says, they're going to catch up. Just keep doing what you're doing. They're going to catch up. Amen. Also, I hear the Lord saying that the prayer in this house is going to change. That's going to be an area that you're really going to catch a new concept in. And when you catch this concept, you're going to see a difference in your church, where right now it appears to be to you a little passive, a little laid back, and it's not, you know, as go-getting as you want it to get. God says, I'm going to give you another view in the area of prayer, and you're going to launch a campaign that you're going to see that some things that seem to be dead, some things that seem to be quiet and not have life, God says, this prayer is going to breathe life in it. I see the music in this church changing. You hold yourself back. There's more radicalness to you than you let out around a lot of people because, you know, you're trying not to offend, and you want to be this to this person and that to that person, and you want to be a father too because you got a lot of men in here who are brokenhearted and who didn't have the father image to know how to move life. So you're walking very cautiously right now. The Lord says, I loose you today to be who you really are, said the Spirit of the Lord. God says, no longer will you live in a box of what you think people want from you. But the Lord says, you're going to do that I've called you to do and be the person I've called you to be free in doing it, said the Spirit of the Lord. I hear the Lord saying to tell you, make no apologies for who you are. Make no apologies of the changes that you want to bring. Make no apologies of the way that you see that I'm telling you to build, said the Spirit of the Lord. For you don't have to look like this house, and you don't have to look like that house, and you don't have to look like that house, but you have to look like the vision, said the Lord, that I'm giving you. And yes, it's different, said the Spirit of the Lord. But God says, I didn't make you from the mold of others. I made you different on purpose, said the Spirit of God. Amen. You have authority. You have authority. Walk in the authority. You have authority. Walk in it. You let your no's be flat no. Let your yeses be emphatically yes. But you have an authority. You are the pastor's wife. When he's not here, you stand in his stead and you stand in your authority, said the Spirit of the Lord. Amen. Too concerned about being offensive to others. Stand in your authority. Amen. God bless you. You can clap. Remember, I'm a senior pastor. You can clap. Amen. Praise the Lord. God bless you, bless you, bless you. Many great things ahead. I see a street ministry that will birth forth. Amen. And it will be radical within the doings. I see the arts of this church really coming alive, really coming alive. And it'll be a tool that you'll use on the outsides of these walls. And there's a fresh wind. There's a fresh breathing that's going to come through your church. There's a newness. I see where the Lord is telling me to tell you that the foundation it was built on is a good foundation, but God says, I'm tearing that up and I'm re-erecting and re-pouring some things. And it's not that you, getting rid of vision or getting the Bible out. That's not it. But God's going to do something fresh and he's going to do something new. Amen. And it's going to be good, said the Spirit of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. So thank you for welcoming me to your home, your house, your family church. Amen.
Amen.
That don't make me feel welcome.
Yeah.
I can be a little comical now, okay? But now once you finish just kind of read me over, yes, I have blue hair. Amen.
Amen.
And yes, I do the nails. And yes, yes, I got the little flamboyance on me. So now that we know that, we okay?
Yeah.
We all right?
Yeah.
You good now?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Okay. So yes, I'm a woman pastor, senior pastor. Yeah, I run it. It's okay. It's okay. Yeah. All right. Now, I'm just loosening you up. Okay. All right. I'm a business owner. Look, they need a little more. You can tell it. I'm a business owner. And let me put it this way. I make that money. You all right now?
Yeah.
So now you can understand why I got a little bit of authority on me, okay? So I do own several businesses. Amen. I run them very effectively, I think. Amen. I think it has brought me to a lifestyle. God uses me. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Y'all got to learn how to talk and speak up. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. Amen. One of the things I can tell you about me is I love prayer. How else are you going to contact God if you don't love prayer? Amen. I love prayer. Praise the Lord. So with me, I think I kind of do it right in the eyes of God. So y'all okay now?
Yeah.
Now you know I'm saved?
Yes.
Okay, good. Praise the Lord. I've come today to talk to this house about your faith. One of the things you'll hear me say about the earth that we're living in today, the church is so laid back and the church is so still and so quiet that we don't have a voice. And the reason we don't have a voice is because we're not doing things by faith. We depend on our jobs. Amen. And for the most part, a lot of us live from paycheck to paycheck. And we're always in somebody's prayer line. And we're always in dilemmas. And the reasons we're in dilemmas like that is because we're not faithful people. Amen. And how many of you understand that when the word faith and full comes together, it means that your faith becomes full as well. And it means that you need to be faithful and stand in a position and in a place where God can trust you. You can talk back. Say, oh. So you need to understand that even operating in faith, you have to be committed to it. You have to be faithful. Amen, church.
Amen.
So I want to talk to you today about your faith. Can we do that?
Yes.
Can we do that, Do?
Yes.
Can we do that, Do?
Yes.
Okay. You with me?
I'm with you.
Okay. Stay with me now. All right. I need you in here.
I'm good.
Okay. All right. So I taught this to my church, and I want to teach it to you, and I thought it was a very good message. If you would go with me, please, to Romans 1:17. Romans 1:17, it talks about my subject matter is according to your faith, be it unto you. Mm. According to your faith, be it unto you. You know, like I said when I first started talking, that the church doesn't have a voice, and the church doesn't have a voice because we're not doing great exploits. And the reason we're not doing great exploits is because of the fact that we're very quiet and very still in the church. And the church doesn't have a voice because people look at the church because the church hurts so, and they're so often without and don't have. Now, a little bit about myself. I got pregnant at the age of 15. I'm sorry. I got pregnant at the age of 15. I had my first child when I was 16 years old. And because there was ignorance in my lineage, I was not taught. So because I wasn't taught, I got trapped in a snare of the enemy, being sexually active before my time or before I got married, if you can understand. Come on now, y'all got to loosen up a little bit. Amen. I'm going to tell you where God brought me from. And then turned around at 17, and before 19, I had 3 children. 3 kids. Then I get married to try to correct a mistake, but that was a mistake to get married because I married a man that was not mature enough. He wasn't grown enough. He hadn't grown up. He was a boy himself. I'm a little girl myself, dealing with grown up things. Come on, I'm talking to you. Amen. So then I try to correct a mistake and make a worse mistake. So now I'm not educated, and over in America, they call you a statistic. I don't know if you use that word over here, but I'm a statistic. I'm just set up for nothing but welfare and doom of days. Are you hearing me? I mean, not coming out of high school, any of that. So I struggle through life, and I finally get out of this bad marriage and move my life a little bit forward and buy a home and get myself, you know, kind of situated, so I thought. But I'm in an impoverished area. Stay with me. I'm in a very impoverished area. Are you hearing what I'm saying? My kids, I'm looking at my children, and I'm going, how are we going to get out of this? How are we going to do it? How is my life going to change that I can do good and do well and do better? How is it that I'm going to leave a legacy for my children? How is it that I'm going to leave? How is it that I'm going to lead my kids into better? Are you hearing this? Because how many of you know the environment that you grow up in, it predicates where you're going. Are you hearing me? So I'm in an impoverished area. I'm uneducated. I got these four little kids. I'm divorced. I'm statistics. Then I go down to try to get food stamps and they won't even give me food stamps because I own this little raggedy house. Trying to be a homeowner so I can get my kids out of the apartments. They won't even give me food stamps. Now, in all of that, I have intelligence.
Hallelujah.
I have intelligence. But I have no mentor and I have no one to teach me how to apply God in my life. So I get born again. Amen. And God helps me. These pastors move in trying to close on a house. And this little wife was just a little sweetheart of a woman, a praying woman. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Just love the Lord. Just love the Lord. He was a pastor. And she starts teaching me. And she starts teaching me how to pray, how to talk to God, teaching me how to keep myself right and teaching me how to move forward and how to think. She started showing me how to handle my money. Come on, I'm gonna talk to you a minute.
Yes.
And she started teaching me how to seek the face of God. Then she told me, she says, Verna, you can't live from paycheck to paycheck. She says, you got to start trusting God in the area of faith. So she'd go to the grocery store with me. She said, we're going to believe God that these 40-something dollars go forward. And I'm like, we're in the grocery store. She said, no, but we're going to believe God that this 40-something dollars move a little bit forward. And she had faith on her. I'm like, we're going to get what we can get for these 40-something dollars and get out of here. But lo and behold, as she began to teach me how she operated in faith, God would do little things like we walk down an aisle and we find like if we had to buy little cans of string beans, there'd be four for a dollar. Now, that's her faith working.
Yes.
I never looked for four for a dollar. I just went and got a couple of canned goods, said, we can use this week, and we use this week. But she started showing me little bitty things like that about faith. And she started feeding me faith books. And I want to talk to you about faith because God wants to do something in this church. And it's going to take faith from you, the congregation, not the pastor. Sheep beget... Let me say it again. Y'all got quiet on that one. Sheep beget
sheep.
Not the pastor. The pastor empowers you. The pastor teaches you. He equips you. Amen. That's what they do. But sheep beget
sheep.
And when you can't use your faith because you're struggling in everyday life, you're living from paycheck to paycheck, what you'll do is you'll put pressure on the church or on the pastor because now he sees the needs of the people and he has to turn from the needs of the people and start talking to God about the needs. He has to turn from doing what God called him to do to turn and start talking to God about the needs of the people. But the truth of the matter is he's only set in position and office to teach you how to use your faith that you can live a supernatural, overcoming lifestyle.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
That's what they're called for, to equip you. The other part of your equipping, when he equips you in your faith is to reproduce for yourself, but it's also to reproduce others into the church.
Amen.
Oh, I know what I hit. I'm a senior pastor. Oh, I know what I hit. I hit that laid back spirit like, huh? I got to share my faith. Well, see, you don't want to share your faith because of the fact that you're not operating in faith for your own life. So let's talk about it this morning. Y'all still love me? I just got here. Huh? You love me? You love me? I just got here. You love me? All right, so we want to talk about living a supernatural lifestyle according to your faith. And my first scripture for you is Romans 1:17. And it says, as it is written, the just shall live by as it is written, the just shall live by faith. Are you the just?
Yes.
See, you got quiet again. Now, if you were the just, you said, yes,
yes.
I'm the just. Did anybody walk in my church and ask me, Verna, are you the just? Yes. I'm going to tell you why, because I know I'm living by faith. I'm living by faith. faith is operating in my life. Amen?
Amen.
So let's go to Luke real quick. Luke 18 and 8 says, I tell you that he will avenge them speedily. Nevertheless, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith on the earth? And see, that's what's wrong with the church today. There's no faith that's really operating the way it should in the household of faith. And you're called the household of faith. So why isn't faith really operating in the household of faith like it should? Because we're not taking the time to really embrace faith in our Christian walk. The church has become beggars. We beg God. Every time we get on our knees, we're asking God for something. Every time we get on our knees, we're asking God for something. And scripture is clear when it says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all of his righteousness, and these things shall be what? Added unto you. Things are added.
Amen.
When you seek the kingdom. And when you seek the kingdom, you do what the word says. Take his yoke upon you and learn of him. And when you start learning of him, the first thing you're going to find out is when he encountered man walking on the seaside of Galilee, the first thing he told Peter is, follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. He didn't say, I'm going to make all your needs supplied. He didn't say that. He didn't say, I'm going to give you a house, I'm going to give you a boo. Y'all know what boo means over here? Y'all know what boo is over here? Okay. He didn't say, I'm going to give you a boo. I told my church the other week, I believe there's a boo store. I'm serious, because when they get rid of one boo, all of a sudden you tell me, this is my new boo. I'm like, where you getting him from? I believe there's a boo store. Amen. But he didn't say, I'm going to give you that. He didn't say. Now, in his word, he declared to you, you'll have houses and lands. But those are called things. Things. And those things come after your seeking of the face of God. Now, when you start seeking the face of God, something's going to start happening called development. You're going to start developing. How many of you went to college? You don't have to raise your hand, but if you went to college, you know, that's what you went to college for. You want to develop yourself so you can live quality of life. Amen. But see, we don't understand that this army that we're in, it has a development system too, so that we can live quality of life, that we can be read epistles. Amen. We can be epistles read of men. Come on, church. Come on, church. Come on with me now. Because, see, you can't convince me to live for the Lord if you can't show me that your needs are met. Because I don't want to get into begging society with you. I don't want to join that. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I don't want to join that society. Amen? I mean, because there's a system in the world like that already. Because see, when you go down to try to get things we call food stamps or assistance, that's the begging society.
Yes.
That's begging. Yeah. Even if you say, well, I'm just filling my papers, I get a little assistance. That's begging. Amen? But he promised to supply all of your needs. But there's a system by way he's created for your needs to be supplied while you're occupying and working.
Yes.
Oh, Jesus. So it's about development. Now, development is crucial to the believer because we wield a sword. What did I say? Development is crucial to the believer because we wield a sword. And we wield the sword with our mouths. So it's what you're saying out of your mouth. You're living today based on what you said yesterday. And we don't understand that as a believer. You're living this moment as of what you said yesterday. Praise the Lord. So again, development is crucial to the believer because we wield a sword with our mouths that could either anchor a person's life or shipwreck it. You don't understand. The words that you speak, they're spirit and they are life. That's why it's so important that you develop in the household of faith, as faith people, as the just that lives by faith. Are you here?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
So Philippians 2:5 says this, let this mind be in you that's in Christ Jesus. Now the church has gotten so far away from the mind of Christ and we're doing our own thing. You know, we don't respect the pastor. We don't honor the pastor. You know, like, hey, pastor put on his pants like I do, one leg at a time when I get up in the morning. But that's a man of authority. And see, your nation has a little more honor than our nation. In our nation, no. I watch the ladies when they approach it, they cursing. And I'm like, Lord Jesus. I think I got to pray some more to get there. But in our nation, ain't nobody cursing. They walk in like, what? I said, come in a minute. What you want? Well, we're having church on Saturday. I got something to do. So what I'm trying to explain to you is, you've got to understand that the system that you operate in, the kingdom of God, has a system. It has a systematic order. And in that order, there's a development. And the way you develop it, you've got to renew your mind from the world system to the king system. Hallelujah. And you got to learn what it is to operate over here in this kingdom that we say we worship in. Now, you're a Christian? Yeah, I'm a Christian. You worship God? Yeah, I worship God. And see, we think worshiping God is just, you know, we get together on Sunday, we worship you, hallelujah, hallelujah. We think we just worship. But worship is a lifestyle. Amen? Let's go to Hebrews 11 and 5. Look what it says about this word of faith. It says, but without faith, it's impossible to please him. And see, if you're not operating in faith daily in your life, if faith is not a lifestyle to you, you're not pleasing God. And see, I told you, we got to do something about this mindset because we don't think of how the kingdom operates and what we're walking in every day. We take it for granted. I'm a Christian, but we think just being a Christian is just walking around with the words coming out of our mouth that we're a Christian. But no. Your Christianity is a lifestyle. Your Christianity should be operative every day. You should see something supernatural every day. And I'm not talking about, you know, you going out to the graveyard and you raising all the dead out there. That's not what I'm talking about. But I'm talking your life should be faring so well that others take notice and say, wait, we work on the same job. Hold on. What's happening here? You can tell them I'm pleasing the Lord with my life. But without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is and that he's a rewarder of them that diligent, there's that word again, seek. That means going after God. That means being a carrier of the glory and the anointing. Amen. Having God every day, not when we come to church. And not when we see another Christian brother. Hey, praise the Lord. All of a sudden we got, but during the course of the day, he's not in our mindset. He's not in the thought patterns. He's not in our actions. I mean, we don't even think on the job to throw our hands up. We're not thankful. Are you hearing me, church? Look at James 2, 18 and 20. It says, yea, a man say that thou hast faith. And if I was to ask each and every one of you in here today before I started this message, do you have faith? You say yes. You're absolutely correct. But my question then would be, have you developed it? Because the Bible says he gives every man a measure, but have you developed it? Now, I told you the beginning of my life was not good. But the day I can stand and tell you that I've developed my faith to the point that I live a very supernatural, great life. Hallelujah. Very supernatural, great life. God has blessed me so that I live first class. When I met Pastor Michael, I was still uneducated with these four kids, and we were still living in the little house that I bought, and we're doing a little bit better, but there was so much more to do. And then I married him, come to find out his family is very educated. And they looking at me like, oh, Lord Jesus. Look what he has brought home. You know, and he started kind of looking at me side eye, and I'm like, oh, Lord Jesus. Just hear me out today. And his mom came to me one day. She said, Verna, it was because talk was going on. She said, why don't you go back to school and get your education? I said, I'm not going back to school. She said, no, you need to. Now, I'm working at IBM, one of the most prestigious companies there are. And that's because I could pass their test and get in. I told you, I'm brainy now. But I don't have a high school diploma. And they let me in. and gave me a good job. And she said, why don't you just go back to school and, you know, and I'll tutor you and help you. And I said, I'm not going back to school. She says, and she said, do it for me. And I really love my mother-in-law. I said, well, I'll go back and I'll get the GED, I called it. I said, I'll get it, but and she said, I'll tutor you. I said, I don't need any tutoring. She said, to pass that test, yes, you do. I said, no, I don't. Now, she's a principal. She's an educator. And she's looking at me going, girl, you need somebody. I said, no, I don't. She said, okay. So Pastor Michael, we signed up and he dropped me off and I stayed at the test for 4 hours. And I came back and said, I'm tired. I used some brains I hadn't used in a long time. So I slept about 4 hours. And we got the results back and they were what?
High school diploma.
I passed just that high. But hold on. Thank you for your applause. I appreciate you. But that still wasn't enough for me to move forward in my life. It was an aid as I go, but it wasn't enough. I'm a Christian, and I'm sharing my Christianity with him. I'm sharing it with her, and I'm sharing it with the family. And they're looking at me like, mm-hmm. But what they were really looking at is, yeah, you just got your high school diploma. God bless you. But you don't have anything. And see, the world needs proof from you.
Yes!
The world needs evidence from you. And see, I can talk like I normally talk.
Oh, yes.
Now, when I rolled up on his parents, they had a Porsche in the garage and a Mercedes in the garage and his uncles and all. I told you, it's a very educated family. They riding around in Porsches and Mercedes. And I mean, people had nice sprawling houses. One aunt, I went to her house, took my breath away when I walked out the back door. The view she had of this beautiful lake. See, there were people of means and people of wealth. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
And here I am with these four little kids walking behind me. This little, this teeny weeny little old car we in. Amen. Praise the Lord. And this little old house that we in and need a whole lot of work. But I'm trying to share my faith with them. So what I'm telling you is this kingdom here that we're dealing with, there's a development process with the system that we're in. You've come out of one system of darkness. Now you're in this system here. And James says, look, yes, a man may say that thou hast faith. He says this, but I have what? Works. Now in the natural arena of them working educationally, I saw their works. I saw their things. Now I'm trying to share Jesus with people who have substance. And they're looking at me like, and the thing about it is they'll tell you, now I go to church, but let me show you how things begin to change. James says, thou hast faith and I have works. Show me thy faith without thy works, and I will show thee my faith by my works. By my works. You listening to me now. By my works. So now when I walk around his family, when I first came in, I told you, they looked at me like, oh my God, what has he done? His father even told him in front of his brother one time watching football, he said, look at your brother, he's ruined his life. He's married a woman with four kids, he's going to struggle. Now his father says, Verna, I said, yes. He said, don't you ever leave my son. Did he or did he not tell me that? He said, don't you ever leave him. You stay with him. Why? Because Verna rolls in a Bentley today. Yeah. Verna owns several businesses today. Are you hearing me? Yeah. Verna thrives. Verna goes first class. Verna eats first class. The house we live in is $1 million+. How did I get there? I told you I had my first child at 16, impregnated at 15, first child at 16, failed marriage, three kids at 19, uneducated. What brought the difference in my life? It wasn't that high school diploma. Because, you know, you don't get a job with a high school diploma making, you know, $60,000 or you even make $50,000 a year just with a high school diploma. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
The difference is I develop my faith in the system that I live in, that I walk in this kingdom that I serve in. I develop something that's not in the earth like it should be in the household of faith called your faith.
Yes.
Come on, church.
Yes.
Your faith. So James is saying here, he says, look, I'll show you my faith by my what? By my works. That's how I'm going to prove to you that there's a kingdom and a system that's alive and well, and it works in the earth.
Amen.
And that's why most unbelievers don't want to come to church, because when they come to church, you might ask them for $5. Not the church, you. You who bring them, oh, by the way, you can help me out with gas. And they're like, I don't want to come. But see, the Bible declares that he wants to make you a blessing. He wants to make you a blessing to be a blessing. And you can't be a blessing when your faith is not operating and it's not proving the proof of the pudding in your own life. But you're struggling. You got to go to the bathroom and the pastor said, we're going to raise the offering. Church.
Hallelujah.
So let's go a little bit further. It says, thou believest that there is one God, but look at this. Thou do as well. He said, but the devil also believes. Now, your belief system is your faith. It said the devil believes. Now, the devil believes that God's going to judge him. The devil believes that if you start operating in faith, that your prayer is going to be answered. He believes that. He knows that. But you don't believe it because you're not living the faith life. You're not walking in faith like you should. Where's my time? Are you hearing me?
Yes.
So it says here, look, he believes and he trembles. And the part of the trembling is because he's afraid you're going to catch the concept of how to operate in this system, in this kingdom system. He's afraid that one day you're going to wake up and go, you know what? I'm the just. I shouldn't be begging God. I should be bringing things out of my mouth based on the word. Amen.
Amen.
For the kingdom and then for myself.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
But it says, but will thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead. It's dead. When your faith is not working, it's because it's dead. It's not producing. Are you hearing me? It's not producing. Which of you would go out and plant a fruit tree and wait year after year after year after year after year for fruit? And you're like, my neighbor's tree is blossoming and bringing. There's something wrong with that tree. Same thing with you and your faith walk. I tell my church the same thing, so don't look at me funny. I'm not coming being hard on you. I tell my church the same thing. I say, the word that you get in this church, we should be blowed up, huge. Because it's not that I'm just talking something, I'm living it in front of you and teaching you the concepts of it.
Amen.
This church should explode. It has the potential to explode. But you've got to get up out of being passive and being lax and being in a position of you need assistance to the fact that, God, you're my God. And I've got to learn how this kingdom system that I'm in works. Hello, church.
Hello,
hello, church.
Hello.
So we got to come out of the place of having our faith not working. We got to get our faith to a place where it works. Listen to me, saints. When you're still crying over bills, over men that left you, women that left you, light, phone, water, and can't hold a job, you're still in competition with others that are blessed. And you might say, well, how am I in competition with them? Well, let's be honest. Let's just really break it down in the church. You know, for some reason, I watch in churches, those that seem to be faring well and those that are not faring well, all of a sudden, you know, they're like, well, they're all right. The truth of the matter is you really want what they got. And the reason you want it is because there's something on the inside of you knowing, and then based on the messages that you hear, you know that your life should be doing better. But we don't want to take the time to develop. That's a key word. We don't want to take the time. We sleep in church. We turn off in church. Amen. Yeah. And after we leave church, we set everything we learned down. We're not diligent. We're not diligent in our approach of causing this word to come to pass in our lives. And the truth of the matter is, what I'm telling you this morning, what I just said, you're spiritually immature. You're not growing. You're ever learning, but you're not growing. And there's a difference in ever learning. Ever learning means you come here and you come to just hear, write notes, and stack them up. I remember one day when I went in my closet, I had all these notebooks, and the Lord said, "What are you doing with them?" All these tapes I buy, and he said, "What are you doing with them? Are you operating in what you're gathering?" He said, "That's information, but if you don't take it and act on it, it'll never benefit your life." Are you hearing me, church? You know, there's a nursery rhyme that we all learn when we're little. And I guarantee you right now, any nursery rhyme that you learn when you were little, somebody starts singing, you could pick it up. That's because you didn't just hear it, you learned it. You developed it in the tracks of your mind. So, Romans 10:17 tells us something. It says, "So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." How much time are you spending in the word? That's another thing that we Christians do. We don't really spend time in the word. We watch, y'all got power over here? See, he put his hands up. He like, he's a power fan. See, you got a green leaf, and you don't have green leaf? You don't want to watch it nowhere. It's a mess. But we spend more time before that, what y'all call it, television or telly? Television? Okay. We spend more time before that television than we do in the Word. You think your faith gonna work? If I was to ask you right now, what's your faith project? Could you tell me? I teach my church, and I tell myself all the time, I encourage myself, when one faith project manifests itself, I got to have something coming right behind it. I'm not giving my faith any rest. No. This is my lifestyle. This is how I live. I remember I started believing God to fly first class everywhere I went. And I'd make first class, then I didn't make it. Then I said, "God, I said, now, you know, you can hook a sister up." I hear people saying that, you know, they get bumped up to first class. So I start putting my name on the list. I say, "If y'all got any extra seats." And the Lord told me one day, he says, "That's not the way I'm going to do it for you." He said, "You have to believe me." So I had to start believing God for the funds. So I started believing God for the funds. And as soon as I engaged my faith to believe God for the funds start showing up that I started finding flying first class. And not to brag, but every overseas trip, we took one overseas trip and it wasn't first class. I told my husband, I said, "If I fly first class in America, I'm gonna fly first class in Europe." We took one. His legs is all bent up. That's not first class. I'm turned sideways. And that was a long flight. And I got off the plane, I was like, "Oh God, Jesus." You know, but what is your faith engaged in? Seriously. This is your system. This is your kingdom. You operate in this kingdom daily. What is your faith engaged in? I saw something beautiful, bam, that your pastor has up there. Each one reach one. What is your faith engaged in? And see, the problem with the church, we think that we can go out and just win a soul, and it takes faith to win a soul. How are you going to win a whole person and you can't believe God for the necessities of daily life? Faith is a muscle. You gotta build faith. You gotta build it. Faith comes in levels, 30, 60, 100-fold, and then the abundant life. And if you still let a grain of mustard seed, that's why our churches are struggling.
It's all in that mindset. How do you believe? And that's why one of the scriptures that I opened with, I said, will he find faith in the earth when he returns? It's like it's a lost art when it comes to the body of Christ. I have the answer to why churches aren't large. Because the people on the pews are struggling in the areas of their faith. We had the faith movement and it took a left turn. It did. It was good for the church. But it took a left turn because people started taking olive oil, going out plastering on people's cars. I mean, I believe God for this car. You don't have a budget. You don't have a budget. I believe God for this house. I had a couple in my church, they're deceased now. I never did get that Mercedes. When God first started blessing my life with a Mercedes and moving me up, they said, Pastor, we believe in God for a Mercedes too. And I'm looking at the husband, he don't work. And then I ask him, I say, have you done your research? See, we just come over here and we become spooky. Yeah. Because we're not developing, we're not learning, we just get spooky. Oh, my faith works. No, has your faith been developed? And I ask him, I said, John, have you gone down to see how much a tune-up on a Mercedes costs? Because it's not like a Chevrolet or Ford.
Yeah.
You know, that's not $99. And all of that has a fit within your budget, which obviously you don't have one because you don't work. But are you getting where I'm coming from? And we just want to reach out and grab these things, and then we have these faith failures. First thing we want to say is faith don't work, and we go right back into the begging line. But faith does work when we take the opportunity and the time to develop ourselves and become the just in the earth. And we'll start watching churches grow.
Amen.
Because, see, you'll be so glad to testify and tell of his goodness. You know, I used to live like this, but now because I'm serving God and I trust him and I believe him, that's your testimony. We overcome by the words of our testimony. You know, now I'm serving God and I believe him and he's brought my life to here and things in my life have changed. Look, I'm the same mother that gave birth to a little girl when I was 16 years old. I'm the same mother. Amen. But my life has changed. I've taught those four kids how to use the faith, use the faith of their mother and develop their own. Mm-hmm. That little girl has built three homes. What, three or two? Three homes now. From the ground. From the ground. Not moved into something that somebody else has lived in. She's built it herself, walked through it. I want this in it. I want that in it. Want this in it. Want that in it. She has a son in the Marines now, a daughter in college, and putting another child through private school. Why? I taught her the system. You must develop. Amen. I got two sons. I got two sons. Both are morticians. One owns two funeral homes. Why? I taught them to use their faith. I said, yeah, you can work hard. You can work hard all your life. But the Bible called you to live an overcoming, supernatural lifestyle according to your faith. Be it unto you. Same thing with the body of Christ. Will he find faith in the earth when he returns? That's important. Will he? And the only way he's going to find it is when he finds it in the household of faith, that you're operating in faith. That's what's going to grow big churches, when we're operating in faith. Now we're sitting back in the line looking for a handout, not trusting God, not believing God. And then time's up.
Also, make sure you add us on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, subscribe to our YouTube channel, and visit the church website.
It's big, but it just got bigger. The Kingsborough Family Church, with support from churches in Oxbridge, Hillingdon and Hayes, presents Holy Night of Praise 2016. 29th of October 2016 at the Bex Theatre, Grange Road in Hayes, UB3 2UE. Doors open at 5 p.m. Ministering are the face of integrity music in Britain, Neil Robinson, international gospel rapper A-Star, Mobile Award winner Rachel Kerr, International Worship Pastor Danny Oates, songwriter and gospel music producer Evans Aboy, God's Own Vessel of Praise Dio Balo, comedian of the United Nations MC Mark, the living act of the Kingsborough Family Church and the host choir HOP. For more information, visit our website at www.hallynight.org. And remember, why Halloween when you can hallelujah?